But there's sharks around here, according to all the locals.
And this is where your seal colony is in here, so that'll be a
lot. That'll be sharks might be in there, they'd love that. I think you'll enjoy yourself.
That's great.
And you may find a mermaid or two on your travels.
Oh, right.
Like we did.
You found a mermaid on this trip. Unbelievable. We're going to know about this at the end of this. Especially if it picks up.
We started from Cape Jarvis on the Fluria Peninsula. Crossing Backstairs Passage is notoriously difficult, especially with wind against tide conditions. Just prior to our trip, two paddlers had been drowned here, just a few kilometres from where we were going to start. It is 18 kilometres across the passage, and we were having to punch into a strong southeasterly. We had made allowances for the tide and hoped that conditions would improve as we got into the lee of Kangaroo Island. We had allowed the outgoing tide to take us down the passage to the east. This meant that we could later on point further west and put up our sails. The stinging salt-laden spray, combined with sunscreen lotion, took its toll on our eyes.
The black shot us.
The consequences of being in the storm.
As we expected, conditions moderated closer to the island. We cruise along the coast towards Pennyshore. We soon had our first experience with Kangaroo Island dolphins. With some relief, we paddled into the bay at Pennyshore. Later, from the comfort of our cars, Backstairs Passage looked benign.
Well, it's been wet.
Nice little climb, isn't it?
It is so.
Having the cars with us meant we could explore the hinterland of Kangaroo Island. We were particularly eager to see what the rugged and exposed south coast looked like. Later, it was back to Pennyshore and a paddle down the coast to American River.
Nah. Around this next point, you're right.
A fresh breeze allowed us to sail into Eastern Cove, but this eventually died out, and we had very calm conditions as we approached American River.
However, I still squashed the tomatoes.
After visiting the only shop open in American River, we set off to explore the Pelican Lagoon.
Mighty lasted to Darwin.
Keep your trader on your left.
Yeah.
Hey. They like to bring mattress there, don't they?
And that's a green tarp, by the way.
Why have I got a smile on my face? Because Rex is paddling and I'm not. Another wet day in camp.
And the bloody fish and chip shop's closed.
And the pub.
The pub. Can you believe this place?
American River.
We had decided to tackle the north coast of the island first. This would be easier paddling, and allow us to build up to the fearsome west and south coast.
Jamie's not a morning person, is he?
Our destination today was Kingscote, Kangaroo Island's major town. Leaving American River, we sailed around Point Morrison and into Nepean Bay.
It's like mum and child.
We stopped for a closer look at the interesting red banks before a heart-stopping moment for Rex. Then we hoisted sails to take advantage of a strengthening southeasterly for the run to Kingscote. After a surreptitious overnight camp near the Kingscote Yacht Club and a look at the Bay of Shoals, we set off for Emu Bay. First though, we had to navigate the complex of sandbars in the Bay of Shoals.
Look now as the sky falls and rises up again. Look at yourself here.
Yeah. After a fairly uneventful paddle around North Cape and White Point, we arrived at Emu Bay.
Is it worth being here tomorrow?
Not necessarily. You can land there, because I wrote that in. That's from Peter Carter.
Right.
From his trip report.
You know what it's like sleeping in a flat mattress all night?
From Emu Bay to Stokes Bay would take us past some interesting features, including areas frequented by white pointers.
I like that.
A few offshore reefs and the Dashwood Bay dolphins.
Lunatic. Must be a reef there. Because it doesn't break very often.
Our first excitement for the day was a bit of surfing practice on an offshore reef.
Yeah.
nutrient near where the water's coming out.
We passed an extensive abalone farm before chatting with some local divers who warned us about the south coast and mentioned we had just passed an area known for its white pointers.
Yeah. We're hoping for some more weather like this.
Did you get that on film? The most white pointers I've ever seen.
Where was that reef?
Just near that reef. Probably the one we were surfing, probably.
Our next excitement was meeting up with the Dashwood Bay dolphins. We were told people visit this area just to swim with them.
Aim left a bit. Left, left. Cape, you see?
Capes are meant to be
bigger than a point.
Cliffy.
Passing the somewhat disappointing Cape Cassini, the coastline became more interesting, with cliffs and rocky passages to negotiate. Stokes Bay, we had been told that the landing spot and camping ground was just past the beach. To begin with, we were a little doubtful of finding it, but it was tucked away in the corner of a boulder-covered bay.
Easy. Easy.
See
at
the top?
Yeah.
Here we're going to store the boat, okay. Oh, well, just drag
it up. The local shack owners were very helpful, giving us advice about conditions and landing spots further on, as well as a huge bag of freshly cooked marron and a nice cold beer.
Yeah, depending on the weather and whatever. I'll move.
Swallow dive.
We then negotiated the hole in the rock to get to the beach and its protected rock pool. The cliffs and rocky coast continue to offer interesting paddling, with the odd rocky passage. Before leaving from Kingscote a few days ago, we had done a car shuffle to Western River Cove, so we were familiar with the landing spot.
And when the end's in sight, the heart just gives a flutter.
We intended to continue this leapfrog policy right around the island.
That's a bit of flooring, isn't it?
Bad work, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
the roast of the day down at the pub. What if it's pork with apple sauce?
Today we're doing the car shovel to West Bay, as well as visiting the Cape Water Light Station. We also wanted to have a look at Hanson's Bay on the south coast. Both areas had potentially tricky landing spots. The Cape Border Light Station has a special significance for sea kayakers. It is one of the weather reporting stations that gives daily information about wind and sea conditions, as reported by ABC Radio at 5 minutes to 6 each morning. On our expeditions, we rely heavily on this information in order to plan our route and itinerary. Firing the cannon at 1 o'clock was a traditional way that passing ships could check their clock.
3, 2, 1, 5.
Phil, the head ranger at Cape Border, was very helpful, giving us detailed weather information about the next few days.
Wednesday, if it goes around northeast, it's coming this way, so that's perfect for the west coast. The one thing you don't want to see is southwest, wind southwesterlies, which pushes you on the cliffs.
Later that day at West Bay, we realised that landing on the west coast of Kangaroo Island was going to be a challenge. We planned to be landing here in 3 days' time, hopefully with a lot less swell. Not that that bothered the dolphins. Back at Western River Cove, after our reconnoitre, we set off for Snug Cove, which is only about 15 kilometres further west. Prior to the trip, Steve Weston had told us to expect sea caves and seals along this stretch of coast, and we were not to be disappointed. Good man. From the sea, Snug Cove didn't look anything like what we had expected from the tourist postcards, but the facilities were greatly appreciated.
I mean, it's been there for 100 years. Better leave it alone.
We were now at the western end of the sheltered north coast of the island. From Snug Cove to Harvey's Return, we were passing some of the highest cliffs on Kangaroo Island. near Cape Torrens, we came across wreckage, which we think was from the Portland Maru that sank here in 1935. The ship had started to founder at Cape de Kudik and drifted up the west coast to sink here, over 80 kilometres away. The weather forecasts were proving accurate, and the 6 metre swells of 2 days ago had subsided as we landed at Harvey's Return. This would be our last sheltered landing spot for a while.
Hey, I don't want to go that way. Why do you want to go that way?
The rocks.
As it should be.
Harvey's Return was the site where supplies were landed for the Cape Border Light Station.
It is. Tasman and Matt Syker.
Well, I haven't seen Matt Syker yet.
Not quite as steep as Tasman, like we were told.
This is where the horse turned around.
Yeah, it'd be pretty amazing. They had a capstan wheel.
Yeah.
When passing the Light Station Cemetery, we pondered as to why there were two headstones for the same G.W. Woodward, who died in 1858. At Cape Border, we checked the weather again. It was still favourable for our landing on the west coast. We also checked the sea conditions from the Cape Border lookout. While looking at the calm conditions below, we wondered what West Bay would be like tomorrow.
Yeah, you don't want that one.
See, there, now it's coming across.
It's 5:30.
Time to get up.
Unfortunately.
Let's hope we have a safe landing today.
Your go, you're on, camera one.
We had a very early morning start from Harvey's Return, partly to cover the distance before any winds could get up, but mainly to give us time to return if landing at West Bay was impossible. At least then we would have time to paddle back to our starting place. A local fisherman had warned us that just off Cape Border were a series of big standing waves. These were marked on the marine chart as rollers, waves caused by a combination of tidal currents and shallow water. Fortunately, they weren't in action this morning, but the adrenaline was still flowing. It had been suggested that we attempt to land at the ravine de Casseurs, but one look at the size of the dumpers soon convinces that this was not an option. With the moderate northeasterly behind us, we put up sails and we're making good progress down the coast. Anthony and Jamie had gone in close to the shore and were silhouetted against the cliffs. It was reassuring to see that the fishing boats are out. Some very close to the cliffs. There was still a good swell rolling in from the southwest, so we were somewhat uncertain about the conditions in West Bay. Before the running to West Bay, Anthony and Jamie pumped out. They had shipped a fair bit of water because of a leaking spray deck.
What do you reckon?
Hopefully we don't end up pumping all of this out.
Probably the famous last words, though.
I know.
It's definitely calmer than when we came down last.
Yeah.
There'll probably be a bit of a dump right on the beach, I reckon.
We're going to play that again, didn't
we? Right. Rex and I volunteered to go in first. After a careful study of the wave patterns, we were off like proverbial rockets. But we knew that the swell was considerably less than before.
Left, quick! That's it.
Our main concern became avoiding the jagged limestone outcrops that dotted this corner of the bay.
Left again. Left. Hold it.
Oh, well, that's looking pretty good at this stage. All they got to do is watch out for these rocks. Laugh it. Watch out for the rocks on your right.
Come over this way. Been rougher at Bridport.
Yeah, you don't want that one.
See, there, now it's coming across. And it's
despite the waves being virtually non-existent, we did still manage one capsize for the day as we moved our kayaks along the beach.
It's a fair drag up there, isn't it?
It certainly is. I didn't expect that to be the winning post.
You just walked from Harvey's return, have you? With all that gear. That's not a bad job.
Leaving the kayaks well above high tide mark, Jamie and Rex did the car shuffle before we all visited the Flinders Chase National Park Centre.
Hey? This is where they grab hold of you.
We checked out the swell conditions and landing spot at Hanson's Bay. And then had a delicious whiting burger at Vivon Bay.
I don't know how we jumped the queue.
I think someone said something about some young lovely female. You'll go far in life.
This is the whiting burger.
Oh, look at
yes,
that.
Yes, about to be copied by Qantas.
We'll have to start with one of those.
Pick up the knife.
Nah.
Before returning to West Bay to camp for the night, we visited Admiral's Arch, the Cape de Kudic Lighthouse, and Remarkable Rocks to finish off a pretty exciting day.
Neptune Island, the winds from the northeast at 13
good,
knots.
Good.
At Cape de Kudi, the waves are 2 to 2.5 metres.
Oh, drop.
At 14 second interval.
At West Bay the next morning, we listened anxiously to the weather report and wave height information.
Breakfast.
It sounded pretty good for our trip around the rugged and exposed southwest tip of Kangaroo Island. This part of the trip would take us down to Cape de Coudic, named by the French explorer Baudin in 1803. Here we would have to decide whether to take the shortcut through the inside passage between the cape and the inner of the two Casuarina Islands, or go further out to sea. Of the early morning start rapidly disappeared, and we soon shed kags and jackets.
That's what I'm going to do.
Take kag off?
Yeah. Yeah. Not a million years.
As we neared the cape, we could see that we had been lucky with the weather and sea conditions. We had timed our rounding of the cape perfectly, thanks to Phil at Cape Porter. As we approached the lighthouse, it was obvious that we could take the shorter inside passage. The eastern end of the passage is potentially the most difficult, as large breaking waves wrap around the inner Casuarina Island and break over shallow ground. A passing fishing boat added to the drama. We saw plenty of tourists rushing down to the viewing platform, no doubt hoping for something dramatic to happen. Despite the calm conditions, we still had a few interesting moments as the occasional wave threatened to break over us.
Oh, look at this one. Battle wrecks. Turn onto her. You're right. It's the one after I'm worried about.
Once through the passage, things calmed down a bit, and we headed in to look at Weir's Cove and the haulage way for the Cape de Coudic Lighthouse. The coast between Cape de Coudic and Hampson's Bay offers few landing opportunities. As we pass the remarkable rocks, our thoughts turn to Hanson's Bay, our landing spot about 15 kilometres away. The only safe landing spot at Hanson's Bay is tucked away right in the western corner. It is a narrow channel guarded by reefs on either side.
actually hiking right across there.
From the shore, it is easy to pick the channel. Even in moderate weather, about one in every three waves breaks right across the entrance. We all landed safely, knowing we'd have to run this gauntlet at least one more time. We loaded up all our gear, put Jamie in his dog box, and set off for showers and food at King's Cove. We had safely completed two of the four most difficult legs of our circumnavigation.
Oh, pretty good. Done about that bit. He went into that pothole.
At Kingscote the next day, we had the luxury of hot showers and clean washed clothes instead of smelly thermal.
A cupboard.
Yes, the cupboard.
We sorted our gear, repacked, and visited the local bakery before travelling to the Seal Bay Aquatic Reserve.
Hopefully they'll smile for us.
Run by the South Australian Parks and Wildlife Service, this is Kangaroo Island's most popular tourist destination, and you can see why.
While we're on the beach, the best thing is for us to stay together as a tight group.
Observing just a few common sense rules, visitors can get close to the sea lions in their natural habitat. It's impossible not to make comparisons with seal behaviour and that of humans.
I have that light underbelly. Yep. I mean, the one on the right is covered in sand, so it's a bit hard to tell. They get a bit bigger, and their noses and that are a bit fatter, and their fatter neck. Yep. The pup came around.
He just wants his photograph taken.
Sea lions are a species of seal that can rotate their back flippers when moving at speed.
Do you see he's dragging his back flippers? When he wants to get a bit more speed, he kind of does a rotating the back flippers thing, and then when he wants to get real quick.
In fact, they can move quite fast, even on land.
This
large male shows clearly why they were called sea lions, with its distinctive light-coloured mane. Sea lions are an endangered species. Extensive research has yet to reveal why this colony is on a gradual decline. They are well protected, yet two out of every three offspring die before maturity.
Okay, let's have a look at the wave observations at Cape de Koudik. 6 metres.
Because of an impending southeasterly change and rising southwest swells at Hanson's Bay, we decided to do the leg from Destries Bay to Cape Willoughby next.
Hear the penguins?
This is the longest leg of the whole journey, with only one or two possible landing spots. Once around Cape Willoughby, we would be in relatively sheltered conditions to pen ashore. We were tempted to head straight for Cape Hart, about 40 kilometres away, but instead went to Point Reynolds, a possible landing spot where we could stretch our legs.
Going a bit faster now. That's 7.5. We'll see you on the hour.
Yep.
Going all right.
Fortunately, there was no sea running at Point Reynolds, as just below the surface was a ledge of hard limestone with razor-sharp projections, ready to attack any gel coat.
There's another rock there, right over top of it. It's going to stop us. We can get out through there. Don't want to hit one of those things under the water, do we?
A brief stop and we're off again. On these long crossings we organise to stop every hour to meet up and have a snack and drink. It certainly breaks up the long slogs. We had a protracted discussion as to which cape we were at.
Oh, that's interesting. Yours is quite different.
It is.
See, what they've done here is they've labelled False Cape on is there. And that's Black Point.
Right.
I reckon they've made a mistake. How can it be called Black Point and False Cape?
It turned out that we were both right, but the two maps we're using gave the cape different names. The light southeasterly was giving us some assistance, but it would die out from time to time. As we neared Cape Willoughby, the southeasterly came in stronger and combined with a strong tidal flow made for a more interesting paddle. We had tried to time it so we would have tidal assistance at this stage of our journey. Cape Willoughby Lighthouse was the first one built in South Australia in 1852, just 7 years after the Swan Island Lighthouse in Tasmania. It was designed to help vessels approaching Adelaide through Backstairs Passage. Could be excellent. Our landing spot and campsite for today was Pink Bay.
Here she comes.
Here we go.
We came around.
No, that's where those seals, that's another one, places where those seals are.
The owner of a beachside shelter finally gave us permission to camp here and use the facilities. She mentioned that a number of sea kayakers had used this area in the past. It was good to relax, knowing that we had just completed the longest leg of our journey without any problems.
One for the camera, one for the pot.
It's got some sort of taste.
What's your thoughts for today, Rex?
Well, we're just looking forward to the lighthouse visit at this time. And that paddle back to Penashore, that'll be fantastic.
And it was using this with the wheel oil lamps, that meant that the Cape Willoughby light station was visible 24 nautical miles away.
Yeah, like Max Iker.
I thought
we'd do.
That's
one here, the one you're in.
Yep. Oh! Are you super glued to the wall, are you? I can imagine what it's like.
The view from the lighthouse was magnificent. Back to where we had come from yesterday, and the three identical keeper's houses. No favouritism here.
I've got no spray deck on. Bloody hell, here we go.
The short trip to Penashore started with pretty lacklustre southeasterlies, but eventually they picked up and we started to make good time.
And we cracked the 14. And we can.
It wasn't long before we were at Penashore. That night we camped at Destries Bay. We only had the two legs between Destries Bay, Vavon and Hanson's Bay to complete. However, we decided to wait for more favourable conditions and spend time visiting the caves at Kelly's Hill and the ravine de Cassours.
Now, I'm not a geologist. I don't think you can tell when the fire was unless you use a dating technique.
Wasting.
There's a few that have that sort of curtain effect, I guess.
Half a degree.
And in the middle of a height, because it's just a drip coming down. But really, they've been there for a long time, just nothing's been able to cover it up. Every animal practically on the island almost. And we also have dwarf emu bones, which are extinct on the island now.
After the Kelly Hill caves, we checked out Hanson's Bay again. Although the swell had dropped, there were still breaking waves across the channel.
Quite a ravine really, isn't it?
The walk to the ravine de Cassours had been recommended by a number of people. So although it was a hot afternoon, Rex and I set off on the 8 kilometre round trip. We weren't quite expecting the size and extent of the caves in this area. Remember, we had briefly thought about landing here on the way to West Bay days ago.
Oh, that column there.
In some cases, the sea enters the caves at high tide. Although we had a torch, we didn't have enough time to fully explore all caves.
Look at this, Jeff. See the pasta and the vegetables?
And the plastic bag.
And the plastic bag.
Life's a box of chocolates, Rex.
It is a box of chocolates, and we're going to work our arse off early this morning.
It was about 55 kilometres from Destries Bay to Vivon Bay, with only a small chance of landing near Cape Gantham if it was calm. The weather forecast wasn't brilliant, strengthening south to southeasterlies against a southwest swell. To start with, we had a 15-kilometre slog into the wind and waves. This reminded me of our first day crossing Backstairs Passage, but this leg was 55 kilometres, not 18. We also had to thread our way through the rocks of Osmolani Reef. At one stage, I questioned whether it was worth pushing on, as there was nowhere we could land or even get close to have a look at the coastline.
Well, no, I'm not saying when to paddle. We'll paddle as soon as we can, but preferably not in these conditions.
It seemed we were paddling just to get the trip finished. Jamie and Anthea wanted to finish the trip, and Rex wanted to be back early so he could attend the birthday party. Reluctantly, I gave in, and we continued on. At least conditions would hopefully improve as we rounded Cape Gantham. On trips such as this, I prefer to see as much of the coast close up as we can. That's why I suggested setting aside 4 weeks. Seal Bay is along this stretch of the coast, and we had been told of a small beach near Cape Gantham that had a large seal colony. I'd been hoping to land there for some photographs and video. From time to time, we attempted to go inside the reefs that dot this coast, but each time the threat of breaking waves forced us out.
Go around out to sea a bit though to get to Nobby Island, because Seal Bay protected areas before Nobby Island, and I think there's a bit of a reef that sticks out. I reckon we'll have to go out round that reef before we actually get to Nobby Island. Oh, strike underneath! Whoa.
After passing Seal Bay, conditions seemed to improve, and we headed closer to the shore to see if we could go inside Nobby Island. Around the next cape, the wind and sea picked up a little, and we managed to surf a few good waves. Ahead lay the Vaughan Bay, and this time we knew we had an all-weather landing spot. The Vaughan Bay is the only sheltered safe anchorage for the Kangaroo Island fishing fleet on this coast. Looks like a little channel just there where the sandy bit is. It had been a pretty long day, and the effects were starting to show.
We're just saying illegal campsite number 10.
Pardon?
Illegal campsite number 10.
Well, here we are at the Vaughan Bay, ready for the last leg to Hanson's Bay to complete our circumnavigation. It was very sheltered in the bay, and according to the weather report from the Cape de Kudik wave buoy, swells were only 2 to 2.5 metres outside. There were a few capes where the seas were confused, but there were no problem. It was a warm and sultry day with the possibility of a thunderstorm and northerly winds. Thank you. as we paused on our last hourly break outside Hanson's Bay, the big question in everyone's mind was, how big is the sea across the channel? We would soon find out. From out at sea, it is sometimes nearly impossible to see features that stand out clearly when on shore.
That's the edge of the reef where it just sprayed up already. No, that's... Oh, I see what you mean. Do you reckon it's in here?
No.
Just back off a bit.
We had to be able to see the channel to avoid the reefs and then time our run between big sets. Rex and I scooted through in record time when I raced up to the point with the camera, ready to video Anthea and Jamie coming in. We had arranged for them to wait for me beforehand. Anthea and Jamie waited patiently as a couple of big sets went through, then timed beautifully for their run into the shore. There were smiles all round.
Why didn't you take the one before?
The one with the back pedal, though. Yeah. Oh, look, a bit tame before you did it.
I thought,
So how many of them broke across?
Oh, the two broke right across just before we came in.
Yeah, another one behind it, though.
There.
Was this the Last Supper before crossing Backstairs Passage, Rex?
Cholesterol needed.
Light south to southeasterly winds, with waves less than 2 metres, was the forecast. We waited until there was about 1.5 hours of outgoing tide left, then set off for Cape Jarvis across Backstairs Passage. Initially we raised sails, hoping that the light southeasterly winds would freshen later in the morning. After about 2 hours of paddling, the winds died down to nothing, and it was like paddling on a mill pond.
Lighthouse man, I'm all I see. Shining at lighthouse, lighthouse man.
As we neared Cape Jarvis, a pod of juvenile dolphins surfaced for a few moments. Maybe they're saying farewell. The wharf and ferry terminal soon came into view, and we started to realise that our adventure was nearly over.
Here's to the,
yeah.
The big circumnavigation.
The circumnavigation.
Yep. Yeah.
Around Kayaking.
Oh, definitely vintage.
Oh,
yeah, it is.
Oh, man. Now, that's just what you need in the middle of a hot sunny day.
Kangaroo Island straight to the head.
Absolutely.
Maybe you'll go to sleep for a while.
Isn't any mad dogs at Englishmen?
Drowning murky depth. On reflection, we had a great trip. Lots of interesting paddling with good friends. We had paddled over 540 kilometres and probably driven around the island three times over. I think we would all agree that Kangaroo Island is a great sea kayaking venue for experienced paddlers. And you never know, you too may be lucky enough to see a mermaid.